produced for personalized consumption, you don't necessarily need mass manufacturing and the factors of production which served us in the past. 3D printing is even removing the need for having these big factories. You can produce things, you know, in your kitchen, right? Things like that. So my first, viewpoint for you is that the future in which the industry has evolved is going to be drastically different from the past. And here are the reasons why. That, you know, these are the things which are happening. Customers are going to demand services, very personalized. Technologies are going to allow you to not necessarily rely on the economy or scale of the past. Things can be produced in small ways. Large companies don't necessarily need to exist in the same way as before. And this part, I think, is very, very important for everyone to keep in mind, because a lot of us have been trained to become a cog in a large wheel, and many of those wheels are now falling off and disappearing. If you look at lots of large companies, they just simply go away. So I think, therefore, the concept of career path, which has been created and etched in our head, in my mind, does not exist. The concept of market, in my opinion, does not exist. Because, you know, people keep asking, so what's the market asking for? What's my market value? What should my career path be? I think those concepts will soon become very strange concepts and will cease to exist. I'm already seeing it happening to me, people around me, because there is no market. Someone in the morning called me and said, explain to me what he's doing and how he's doing. He's probably worked for 18, 20 years. And he was saying, okay, so why don't you tell me what's the market like? You know, where do I stand? And how, I said, I don't think there is a market. And maybe tomorrow you will just not be marketable at all. So forget about, you know, being, you know, having a price for that. You may just not be in the market totally, because things get done that way. So if you have to think about your career, the first lesson from this, in my opinion, is that don't imagine the past is a good predictor of the future, which is what we learn in data analysis. I don't think it's a good predictor of the future. In fact, I would tend to argue it can actually be the exact opposite. Because if I really look at some very, very macro trends, they are going exactly in the opposite direction. So when I, you know, graduated from college, the world was globalizing. You know, everything was becoming flat. Now I think you are inheriting a world which is deglobalizing, and it's not going to stop anytime soon. So the whole globalized system has allowed a lot of things to happen in a very globally distributed manner. And if that's going to change, I think your life might be very different. Many of us worked for large, you know, multinational companies, because those are the companies which were ruling the world. Today, if you believe in the PwC report, which says by 2040, India will overtake US in the GDP terms. So probably in the next 25 years, most of the employment and value creation will happen in India. Probably by Indian companies, because I don't think most multinational companies have been able to make any meaningful mark in the Indian market. They've all used India for a global delivery model, but Indian market, I don't think they get it, they won't get it, it's very different. So again, those things will be very different. So many of you might just get employed in Indian companies. My generation felt that multinationally is where the value is and where you have to go. You're already seeing a lot of multinationals exiting India because they can't figure it out. It's too risky. Most banks have already exited. Banks have, by the way, never made money in a meaningful way in this country because of regulation and because of the difficulty of data and so on and so forth. So that's my, you know, worldview about how the industries are evolving and how the employment will evolve and what world awaits you, and some of the things that happened to us may not happen to you. So that's macro picture. Now the my personal journey of what I have seen and what I have done and, what you could potentially learn from that. So, as you heard Anupa talk about my background, in many ways I have had a very privileged background of having been educated in a large city, in some good institutes, in some good companies and so on. But when I look around at people of my age and even my vintage, I mean, it's not as if that, you know, everyone is, you know, having a great career. So, you know, many times people believe that if you have all of these good things, those inputs will naturally translate into great outputs. On the same time, there are many friends of mine who did not have those things. They were probably, you know, educated in a small town or a small village, didn't go to the best colleges, but they're doing pretty well. So again, some of those theories that you come across, and I'm not saying you shouldn't have those, but if you don't have it, don't imagine it's necessary for success. I think it's probably not an SEO success. So my career journey has been like this. I was born on the day Neil Armstrong landed on the moon. Then from there on, stayed in a small town called Gorakhpur, where my dad used to work in a fertilizer factory. From there on, I moved to Delhi, where I was sent to modern school, Barakamba Road, which is a pretty fancy school. And the reason I was sent there was that My father, who himself had gone to IIT Bombay, having been educated in a small village, studying under a lamppost, those kinds of things that you see in the movies. And when he reached IIT Bombay, he knew only one language, which was Bhojpuri, which is where we came from, Eastern UP. And he felt that, these guys from modern school were talking some very good English. So when we reached Delhi, I realized later on, that is the reason I was put in that school, that, IIT to main pacha dunga, but English, I think the school should teach you. So that's why I was put in school. So yeah, of course, one school did teach me some English, and my dad made sure that I went to IIT Delhi because he filled all the forms. He made sure I studied math, and he ensured that I went there, and he also ensured that my brother went there. And then he left us alone, and he said, because in his worldview, if you got a good education, the ROI was for the next 30, 40 years, because that was the framework in which he grew up. I don't think my daughter, who just joined Christ College 2 months ago to study economics, maths, and statistics, that we have educated her and she's in a good college and that's it. I think that world will be very different, and we'll talk about that. So I think that's how I landed up in IIT, and then my dad said, do whatever you have to. Like all the kids of that generation, everyone was writing GRE to try to go abroad because those were the times, and US seemed to be the best place for everyone to go, especially engineers and so on. I wrote GRE twice because first time I wrote, the paper got leaked, first time in the history. So I had to write it again. But after that, I think the best thing that these education institutes do, and I think all our education institutes should do that, is they ask you to write a statement of purpose. And if you seriously start thinking about writing a statement of purpose, you realize that you have no purpose. Right? So after writing a few statements of purpose, initially by copying from some others, sometime by thinking about it, I realized, frankly, I don't have a purpose to study master's in electrical engineering, which even at the bachelor level, I couldn't figure out why those electrons are jumping around and what they're doing and why am I studying about them. So I sort of stopped applying. I said, I can't do master's in something which even in the undergraduate level, I wasn't, really excited about. So anyway, thankfully, I got admission to IIM Ahmedabad. That was also a very strange coincidence because IIM Ahmedabad is usually considered to be the premium institute, and usually people who get that get everything else. I didn't get any of the others. For that, also, there is a reasonable explanation. So these institutes typically ask you to go through a group discussion and interview and so on and so forth. And kind of quiet kid that I was in those days, it was very hard for me to participate in any sort of group discussion. So I kept quiet in most of those places. The Ahmedabad folks said, everyone gets 2 minutes. So I got to speak something. I don't know what I said. But I suspect that is probably the reason that at least I spoke something. They gave me some marks for that, and therefore I qualified. Everyone else rejected me. So anyway, long story short, I went there. So after that, when I graduated, I joined a company called Feedback Ventures, which was a consulting company, which was, new industry. A consulting like McKinsey, BCG, these types of things had not happened back in 93, or they just started to happen. So consulting was a new industry in those days. And some of the alumni had gone there, and they were the founders of the company, and they said, great company, startup. Those days, actually, startup was also not a big craze. But some people said, yeah, startup will be a nice thing. And my dad felt that I was making a mistake. I should have joined a public sector company and things like that, because that's where he spent all of his career. And he felt the government companies and government jobs are nice jobs and so on and so forth. But anyway, so I joined Feedback. After 2 years, I realized I'm advising big CEOs on what they should do without having any clue about how the world works. So then a friend of mine who was working in ICICI, he said, this is a good company and these guys do some good work and you learn a lot. So he introduced me to his boss, whose name is Sandeep Bakshi, who now heads ICICI Prudential, who interviewed me and they gave me a job. So I spent time in ICICI. I think ICICI was the best learning experience for me, because I realized, and you all will know, that if you give money to someone, you always learn a lot, because you're always worried whether it will come back or not. So I still remember Mr. Bakshi's words in the first listing that, Pankaj, in our business, we make 2 rupees on a good loan, but we lose all 100 on a bad one. So remember, the odds are 50:1. It's not 1:1. So I think that's a very, very, good learning from a banking perspective, which, I kind of learned and kept with me. So I say it's a great, good learning. Usually there was a phrase in ICICI which said that at some stage you should stop learning and start earning. And the reason for that phrase was that ICICI was more like a government pay company. They didn't pay a lot. And a lot of people after a while would go and work for a multinational or some such company. And I was also getting married, and some people were telling me that, your wife doesn't work, two of you will be there. Looks like ICICI may not be the best place and all of that. So thankfully, someone in G Capital called me for a reference check for another colleague of mine. And he felt that he probably has a job for me also. And long story short, I got hired in GE thanks to that ref check process. GE, of course, was not just a earning company, but I thought it was a big learning experience also. And many of you have heard about GE. In those days, I don't think at least I didn't know too much about GE, except that the earning part, which people said, yeah, this company pays well and it's an American company and so on. But GE is, I think, a fascinating company. How all kinds of diverse businesses in one place, leadership development, things about processes, so many things that I learned there, being a Six Sigma person, operations, credit, all kinds of things. And then in those days, this whole BPO industry was going very rapidly, and GE had also created a company called Jekis, which became Genpact. And a lot of people were getting hired there. We were like in a commercial finance company, lending money to people, 40, 50 of us. But on the side, there were these 5,000 people doing some work which sounded very fancy. They would travel to the US and they'll do fancy things. And a lot of people felt that, yeah, that's an interesting job, some interesting lifestyle, something new is happening over there, and so on. So that's where I was picked up by a ex-GE person who had started Standard Chartered Bank's back office operation in Chennai. His name is Romy Malhotra. So he hired me in Standard to sort of help set up the bank's back office operations in Chennai. And then I had the opportunity to also work in Singapore for a while, where they had the head office for that center and they were controlling the back office. And then I came to Bangalore and Dell in 2005, 12 years ago, to work for Dell, where for the last 8-9 years, I helped set up the internal analytics team, which was referred to in my introduction, and which is the reason I think I was called here. So I'll talk a bit about that as well, because Arvind was worried that I'll not talk about analytics at all. So I said, no, I'll talk about analytics. So and then a year and a half ago, last January, I joined Wells Fargo in a transformation team where we are doing something similar. So these days, you know, there are these transformation team which do analytics plus 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 digital and so on and so forth. So that's been my career journey. So if you look at, or at least if I look at in hindsight, what did I do? How did I take those decisions? You know, we all talk about database decisions versus gut feel based decisions. All my decisions were all gut feel based decisions. Even today, they are all gut feel based decisions. I don't believe in any data because I don't know whether how to use data. Data is useful to some extent, but in most big decisions in life, I haven't, leveraged data. If you look at all my career choices, someone said, this looks like a good company. Yeah, if you say so, and so on and so forth. And so I keep talking to people about, you know, decision-making, because this is what we talk about. I said, in my life, what I have done is, most decisions that have to be taken, which are regular in nature, I have, processized them and made them very simple. So just to give you an example, for every day of the week, I have an alarm, right? So 6:30 a.m. on Monday to Friday, 5 a.m. on Saturday, and 6 a.m. on Sunday. So that's my waking up time. Now I could go here and there, but that's fixed. On weekdays, I will get up and I'll go to office, and my dress code is almost similar. There is a navy blue pant from Raymond's, which my first boss in Feedback Ventures, who was a consulting company, said, you should wear these nice trousers. I never change them. I go to the Raymond shop, when they get it, make me another one. White or blue shirt. So my dressing is no decision making. Friday, sometime will I wear a jean? Should I wear a pink shirt or a yellow shirt or a blue shirt sometimes? But yeah, those are also very simple. So most decisions in life have been, just processized. I don't think about it. They have become part of my habit. And most large decisions don't need data. So I'm a very non-analytics-based data decision-making person in my personal life, right? So that determines the type of worldview that I'm sharing with you, that, yeah, some of these things are important in a limited way, but a lot of big things don't necessarily happen based on that. So I think having said what I know, what I don't know, who I am, I thought this is important for you to know for what I'm going to suggest. Because, whatever I'm going to tell you, what I think is going to happen or what you should do, is based on what I have seen, right? Everyone is there in their silo. And we have to remember that whether it is your parents, whether it is me, you have to understand that silo. Where are these people coming from? And why are they saying it? And are there other things that I observe? And therefore, should I add that data into this and then form my own business, is how I would say you should look at it. And many a times, a lot of people will tell you things which might come from a very limited background and silo, and you may have nothing to do with that silo, in which case you should just reject all of it because that doesn't apply to you. So I think it's very important to listen to people like me or whoever comes in and talks to you to understand where are they coming from and why are they saying it and what has made their thought process like that, and is it even relevant to you? So I think you should always question what someone is telling you and form your own decisions and opinions. So like I said in the past, my personal view is that the future is going to be very, very different from the past. And each of you should not compare yourself to anyone who's sitting next to you or anyone for that matter, because each of you have the opportunity to form a career path which did not exist. So in the past, it was almost assumed that you were an engineer or a doctor, and you know everyone will follow and go to Infosys or Wipro or whatever. Those are the types of opportunities. Today, the world is getting disrupted like no one can. If you just look at the trends, people like Amazon, Google, all these companies did not exist. They have disrupted every industry. Google, I say to people, is a universal competitor to everyone because they have all the data in the world. They have the best technology people. They can choose to enter any business. They could enter banking tomorrow if they had to, because banking is all about information arbitrage. But they chose to enter autonomous cars. My suspicion is because the auto industry was down in the dumps, the competition was low, they thought, let me enter that, versus banking, which is still, you know, very, very competitive. Lot of regulations. I'm just making it up. I'm just saying that, you know, so companies like Google and Amazon could do anything tomorrow, and there is no company or industry which is safe from there. So therefore, the concept of industry, the concept of business function, they're all getting decimated. They will cease to exist. So all the, you know, mental models that have been created in the past are unlikely to hold true. So if you were to ask people that, you know, what skills does the market want? They will tell you what they think they want or their company wants, which is not bad, but you should know that that's what they're telling you, because there is no market. The market is getting redefined and disrupted as we speak. And therefore, following someone's advice on what you should do is fraught with risk, and you should realize those risks. I think one of the things that someone famous said was, no one wants big data, but everyone wants big impacts. So I think that's the bottom line that you need to figure out. How are you personally going to create an impact in whatever company or function or area that you are getting employed in? And that impact can come from several sources. If I look at my own career journey, I was a Six Sigma guy once in GE. Then I became an analytics guy. Anyone familiar with Six Sigma concepts? No. So Six Sigma was a concept which was very popular in the manufacturing days. GE popularized it, Motorola popularized it. I think it's a concept that everyone should learn and understand. It's a very, very simple concept. They say that everything is a process which can be improved. My own personal view is that my life is a process. I need to be a better person today than I was yesterday. So I can apply Six Sigma to that. Six Sigma, the basic principle is DMAIC. Define, measure, analyze, improve, control. Very simple. You define what you want to do, measure it, the baseline, analyze it, improve it and control it and keep it there and not let it go back, right? Very simple process. So the A in DMAIC, analysis, is the analytics that you are focused on. So unless you have the view of improving a process or disrupting a process or doing something different, that A in itself is meaningless. So the context is supreme, the define is supreme. Even in Six Sigma, they used to say in that those days, analytics was not such a big deal. They would say, if you did the define right, you got it. And most people will get the define wrong. And the reason we get it all wrong is that, again, like I said, in the past manufacturing era, definition was not required. We required cogs in the wheel to execute. We did not need people to define anything because the definition was done by someone. And the definition held true for a long time, so you didn't have to keep redefining that. So if you look at our examination system, what does it do? It asks you to solve 8 problems or 10 or whatever. Sometimes it gives you a choice to solve 6 out of 7 and people get confused, really confused, right? Right? So we are not taught to define. If I told you, you have 3 hours for this math paper, solve the most interesting problem you think is worth solving. Most people will leave the paper blank. But that's what is the requirement for today. There are no problems out there. You want to figure out what's worth solving and what is it that you can solve better than anyone else. But again, there is a mental model that someone should tell me what to do and I will do it. So I'm saying that mental model has to go away. And the more quickly you let that mental model go away, the easier it is for you. Because all of us have lionized the art of problem solving as a huge sort of advantage and a huge capability. I think problem solving is a skill which can now be available for free. Have you heard of Kaggle? You should have. I can post a problem on Kaggle, and maybe a Hungarian or a Polish physicist who's getting bored might just solve my problem for free. So why do I need you? He might solve it better than you and for free, right? So problem solving is commoditized. And in this global digitally connected world, I can probably get many problems solved for. I think the thing which is not commoditized is defining the problem or saying what is it required in this company, in this context, at this point in time, and so on and so forth, which I think is a very, very hard skill to find because no one has been trained for that, right? Even today, people, you know, expect someone to tell what to do, how to do. I think the freedom within framework is only about, okay, should I use this, you know, random forest model or some other, you know, Markovian model and all of that. But, you know, that's not where the value is. The value is really in figuring out how to make big impact. Like I said, not big data, but big impact. And that big impact concept will keep changing. So like I said, Six Sigma, to me gave rise to analytics, which was, in my opinion, a subset of Six Sigma. And now what I'm doing is I'm in a transformation team. What we are saying is, in this world, you can't remain happy with continuous improvement and incremental improvement, which was there in the past. Now you have to disrupt and transform. And therefore, the tools and technologies available in transformation are more digital in nature. So you have to use other types of techniques, other types of technologies to make big transformational changes. But it's the same continuum that you have to move from here to there, and how can you disrupt and change things before anyone else can? And I think that skill is not necessarily taught. I think the techniques can be taught. There are many good techniques. Like I said, DMAIC can be taught, but how to apply DMAIC? We can teach you RPA or digital or any of those other things. But the question is, do you know where to apply and why to apply? And do you know that in many cases, you don't need to apply it? A calculator or mental math is good enough. And I keep telling people that you don't have to apply a model if it is not required. And you have to make the choice. Just because you learned all of those things, you don't have to apply it. So can you think common sense? I think the education systems sometimes makes us devoid of common sense. So if you can just get your common sense back and then try to judiciously see that the thing that you have learned, when are they required, why they are required, and what you need to do, is what I think the world in future awaits you. In the short run, I'm sure you can learn R and Python and so on and so forth, and you'll get employed somewhere, and that's okay. I think you have to start somewhere, and I'm not saying you shouldn't start somewhere. But as you start, the differentiator for you will be your ability to learn. My dad broke his fixed deposits and said, I will send my son to study, and my ROI will be over 30 years. Because now I have, invested in him, and that's it. Now his career is made. That's the model he had. I can't imagine that Pragya, my daughter, is made. She will continue to upskill herself, and so will you. So will I, all of us. I don't think the world in future is allowing any of us to sit on the laurels of the past and hoping that, all those skills that you learned will remain. Just like a lot of people who are talking about R and Python and all that, these things didn't exist. And by the way, they will probably not exist 5 years from now. So those are good short-term skills to acquire. But if ever you imagine that these will hold, for long run, that will be a mistake. There's another language called S, Julia, which just attracted some funding. Maybe tomorrow you'll be learning S because R has become passe and S has become this thing, and tomorrow it might be T or whatever. So I'm just saying that you got to figure out what is it that is going to be relevant for you, which you are good at. Don't just follow the herd, because I've been telling my daughter that, I think in future, just this math-based, learning is not good enough. So she's, chosen to study eco, maths and stat. I was telling her, you should study psychology, sociology, some of these software aspects, because those are the differentiators which people will not know how to codify. And whatever can't be codified, AI can't do. What's artificial intelligence? Codifying things. So whatever you can think mathematically, which is how you've been trained, that fellow will do. But whatever you can't think mathematically, how will that fellow do either, right? Or even if it does, how do you know he's right? So then you will always be chosen because you seem to have eyes and ears and life and so on, and they'll say, oh, that AI doesn't know, this fellow knows because he's human. But who knows, right? So I think you've got to figure out how will you differentiate yourself from those artificial intelligence engines, which will learn a lot. I mean, people are talking about, Watson and some of these things becoming, and, there are already professors. You guys are probably taking courses on Coursera. That professor can teach 2 million people. Who was that Baidu chief technology officer, whose machine learning course is so popular. So all these people will teach so many people. So the other teachers are irrelevant. So I think we are moving towards a place which is a marketplace economy, where the winner seems to take all. That's the world we are headed towards. Those, look at all these places. They're all marketplaces, and they make huge monopolies without necessarily, calling it that and defining the market that way. So it's a very different world from where it came from. I read an article, yesterday, why someone said Google and Amazon and others should actually be, taken in government ownership. Because they said, these companies in the knowledge economy are the infrastructure. So if the railways and the water utility and those of the past were under government control because they were public goods, which should be owned by the public and not by the private sector, probably these companies are now in a space which should be a public good. And if it is a public good, why should the private sector own it? It's very counterintuitive, very difficult. But today, who knows? And with Trump around, anything can happen. So I hope this doesn't go in a video. But that's really okay. If they can make talk shows about him, so can I. Yeah. So that's, I think, the type of things which are going to happen. So I think I will just leave you with a 3C framework, which I created for Pragya, because when she went to college, my wife said that you should tell her some gyan, you know, as daddy to daughter, on what awaits her and what should she do. So all the MBA daddies know only frameworks, right? Because he has some 5S, 4 forces, some such thing. So I said, let me come up with something. And I said, the smaller the better. So I came up with a 3C framework. And by the way, I checked with her some time ago, and she seemed to remember it. I don't know whether she understands what it means, but she at least remembers it. National Public School does train people to have good memory. So the 3C framework really stands for what are the skills that you should have as you face the career of tomorrow. And I think it was really compassion, confidence, and creativity. And these three are not my own invention, but I kind of derived it based on the market trend that I spoke to you about. Because I have to, you know, you can't tell kids that 3C works and they will, you know, listen to you. So I used economic theory, because that's what she's going to study. I said, I'll use economic theory to tell you why I think these 3 C's will be in great demand in future. And if they are in great demand, you should acquire those skills, because otherwise, you know, less supply, high demand, that's what you should do. So I said, the world is deglobalizing, right? Everyone is getting siloed. Even in companies, a lot of pressure on people. Departments are getting siloed. You know, everyone is looking inward, right? Everyone, you know, who's going to overtake me? There's scarcity around. So everyone, when they look inward, compassion is in short supply. So if you had that, and if you were that person, you're probably, you know, smarter than the others because of that. Second, because of the enormous amount of choices around you, you suffer from ADHD. You don't know what to follow and why to follow. And there's so many choices, and some choices are so new, no one has followed them. So you don't know what to go after. So you go do something, and then you come back, and someone says, this is not worth it. So you have this lack of confidence in pursuing anything, and you end up doing Brownian motion and staying where you were. And therefore, confidence, I think, will be in short supply and is in short supply. And the third one is creativity. That, you know, I mean, these are all good things, but if you didn't create anything, no one pays you money for having nice, good, you know, feelings and good ideas and all that. You have to create something that someone is going to pay for or value and so on. So my personal, you know, advice to you would be at the end of this session, and I'll take questions, is the 3C framework that I invented for Pragya. But I think it is more important for me than it is for her, because I think she has grown up in a different world and she'll probably get it. I think I need to learn that more. Thank you. How much time have we taken so far? I was hoping to do it shorter, because I like to engage more in questions and answers versus giving gyan. You know. So, questions. And I can answer any question, by the way, about whether R is relevant or something else is relevant, whatever it is. So I tend to give more esoteric Gita type of gyan, but I'm happy to answer any specific question you might have. So don't think that I'm not going to answer any of those questions. And by the way, I heard the first talk that you guys attended, which is there on Facebook, from TCS. So I know you guys were asking him a lot of questions. And by the way, you can ask me the same questions. You might get different answers. Kuch maza aaya ki nahi?
We could get one question.
Yeah.
We got one question from Facebook. How is AI the future, and how will it affect our lives?
What was the last part? AI of the future, and how is it?
Affect our life.
Affect our life, yeah. So I kind of alluded to that. So I don't think anyone knows definitively about this. And some of you have heard or read the same thing that I have, which is there'll be a technological singularity in 2040 and the super intelligent machine will come. And by the way, if you haven't done that, there is a very nice website that I sometimes read. It's called Wait But Why. Has anyone seen that? So on Wait But Why, there is this nice article on artificial narrow intelligence, artificial general intelligence, and artificial super intelligence, and how it will evolve. And that fellow obviously is much, much more smarter than I have. So you should read that article. But my own personal view is that some of these things are coming, and they are right now at a very, very infant stage. People have a lot of scenarios and projections of what they will do. But I don't think anyone has a definitive idea. But I do think that, like I was telling you, that in the types of jobs that are going to be more relevant, and I look at it, I think a combination of technology and security, I think, will be in huge demand. Because technology is getting into everything. Cars today have 27% software, right? So automobiles are machines, you know, software machines, right? So everywhere, if there is so much of technology, and we don't understand how these 50 billion machines will talk to each other, which is the world we are going to be. So the types of technology risks that will arrive, and I'm not talking about banking risk, I'm just talking about just standard risk. No one knows. So I think a lot of jobs will come about, so you probably don't need security guard, but you need these types of people who can understand what those risks are and how to fix them, and no one person can fix all the risks. So I think if someone has interest in technology and data science, I think that security and the risk area, it's also related to privacy that we talk about, I think will be huge, because I don't think we have just even touched the surface of it. And some of these will be like the Cambrian explosion, as they say. As these more and more things get interconnected, the amount of risk that will increase will be just, you know, humongous. So I think that's an area. And I think AI is there to stay. It will create new types of jobs. It will eliminate old types of jobs. All of those things, you know, I don't have to tell you that. But I think you have to think more about the new types of jobs that will come out. And also be aware of the old types of jobs that will go away, because you are likely to be in one of those. Because any job that you enter, you should imagine that that whole career path will get decimated. That's how you should enter any job. So when usually people used to enter the job saying, okay, I will get there in 10 years or 20 years. Do the reverse. Say, boss, this is going to go away. By the time I reach my boss's age, neither will he exist, nor will this path exist. Now what do I do? That's the problem you need to solve.
Rahul Shukla on Facebook has asked us another question. What are your views on Facebook closing their AI program? Is it real, or do they want to sort of hide how far ahead of the others they are?
You know, so I probably have the same information as you do, but obviously maybe a perspective that I can share. So I think this is probably related to that, you know, those two AIs which had started talking to each other in some strange language. I don't know why they would have closed down. I mean, obviously, you know, the companies won't necessarily tell everything why they did that. My guess is that, you know, they wouldn't have closed it down entirely. I think it is probably closed down from public view, in my opinion, because I think they are onto something and they are understanding the language. You know, end of the day, what I think a lot of people are trying to understand is, how did language get invented? Because frankly, that's something which is a very interesting question, because most other, you know, animals and others are unable to, you know, come together. And by the way, a bit of a distraction, but has anyone read or heard of a book called Sapiens and Homo Deus? So that these books are very popular these days. So this guy, Yuval Harari, who's a Jewish Israeli guy, he's written this book. And his thinking on human evolution and language and some of these things are that most animals have followed a biological evolution. That, you know, over time you stretch your hand for selfie, after 1,000 years you will have longer hands. Right? That's the thesis of biological evolution. I think his theory is that the human beings are very smart, or whatever, something happened. They started following the idea of cognitive evolution, which is very different from animals, which allows human beings to organize themselves in more. So most animal colonies are not more than 150 people each. And they also tell you, if you are a startup of more than 150, it is hard. Because, you know, human beings more than 150, it's hard to engage. But we have organized ourselves into religion and, you know, countries and armies and all kinds of things. So his thing is, we have invented these cognitive structures, which is countries, nations, all those things, which allows us to beat the biological evolution and just take a different path and evolve much faster than everyone else. And that's the sort of path to AI and superintelligence and all, to which people are talking about. So unless these guys, the machine learning guys, unless they understand language, which is the thesis to human collaboration, you know, you can't create structures and collaborate if you don't know how language exists. So the language research is a big, big deal everywhere. So that part will continue. So I don't know much about the program on what Facebook might be doing with it, but you have to believe where the world is headed and how memory will evolve. You have to understand why and how did language come into being, because unless you understand that fundamental principle, some of these AI things cannot progress. So I don't know what Facebook might be thinking, but I suspect language research is not going to go away anytime soon, because that's I think, at the basis of a lot of these things.
My question is regarding, how do you redefine or recontextualize Karl Marx's markets bound to failure in this disruptive world?
So I think I don't know how the history of markets has been, but market, in my opinion, is a set of buyers and sellers, a set of uniform entities which come together to do something. It could be a market for potatoes, or it could be a market for knowledge, it could be a market for cars and all of that. I think, you know, if I look around, many of these markets are now becoming digital. So earlier the markets were very physical. And the moment they become digital, they surpass the geographical, you know, boundaries. And the way these things are, I think they just confound our previous, worldviews. So earlier, things like Uber or Amazon or some of these things were just not possible, where you can, organize the entire world population in doing some of these things. So I don't know. I think the concept of market is still evolving rapidly. It is not the same market that it used to exist, which was bound by a certain geography, bound by a certain other set of constraints. I think they're just becoming very, very open. All kinds of things are playing into it. So I don't know. I think Google and Amazon are a good example of shape of things to come. I keep telling people that, everywhere in the world, there are these normal distributions. There are some leaders, and then there are some laggards. So you have to look at the leaders, because they are probably doing something which might impact you. So to me, these days, Google, Amazon come to mind, who are just redefining everything, or Uber or whoever. I mean, they are the same concept. So you should keep looking at what they do. In fact, I keep telling our people that, if you have to look at even the talent policies, the hiring policy, the skilling policy, the organization design policies, look at what they are doing. And you may not have to do that, but I think that gives you some clues on how some of the people who are disrupting are doing and thinking. And you may not do that. In fact, one of my close friends once told me, in today's world, the strategy is never to follow. It is also always to leapfrog. Because the moment you follow, that thing will disappear and you will anyway second. So you have to think of the next best thing. You have to start predicting where that ball will land, and you be there before someone else does. So on the concept of markets, I don't know. These markets are just getting redefined in the digital world in many, many unknown ways. I don't know where it will head. I think some of the theories that were created in the past, I don't think they imagined this world. Just like the Newtonian mechanics gave rise to quantum mechanics, I think the old economics is going to give rise to a new quantum economics. I'm just inventing the term, which will be very different, because the boundary conditions have changed. The context has changed, and it is continuing to change. And I'm not an economist, but I'm hoping to learn some economics as my daughter studies. But I think that still work in progress in an evolutionary phase, and some of those theories and models will not hold true in future. Some basics will, but just like Newtonian mechanics is not dead, it is relevant in that context. But just like that, I think. But like I said, not an expert, so don't take my word for it.
Areas that they probably are looking for.
Yeah.
What are the verticals or the domains in the next 12 months, for example, when they graduate, you think are going to be offering more jobs? And what are the type of jobs that these guys have a good chance at getting in?
So, and I meet several people, who are in the job market who are freshers. I tell people that, don't overanalyze, just get that first job that you get. Because no one anyway knows any better. And, the herd mentality, like I said, you can't follow the herd, because if everyone is joining this company or that company, I think what is important is to get into something quickly and then be in that learning mode, saying, okay, what do I learn? Not just from myself, but from my other peers. And sometimes you will realize that many of those other peers who you thought got that dream job that you should have, later on may or may not turn out to be the same dream. So I would say that, there are jobs out there, you are smart people, you'll get some job. Just get that, doesn't matter. And then after that, learn. It's the startup mentality. Just launch a product. Don't wait for the best product. And then learn. So I think the future belongs a lot more to fast experimentation, fast failure, learning and evolving versus imagining the future. In fact, I'm linking it to the economic question that you raised. I think there's a new economic advisor who was appointed recently. I'm forgetting his name. And I was listening to a lecture that he gave. And he was talking exactly this. He said, in the past, we used to imagine that the RBI knows the, what the inflation should be, or many things are very known, predicted, that this is the equilibrium, right? And therefore, we will make policy to go to the equilibrium. He says, that's old-fashioned. Today, you get in, and you learn, and you revise. So I'm not going to decide what interest rate should be. I'm not even going to wait for the best GST process. I will launch GST, but I will learn. In the next iteration, I will improvise. So I kind of like that idea of the future, where I think it has to be evolutionary. And that's the new skill, because some of us imagine that there is this utopia or there is this thing that to go to. I think there is no utopia. You have to just start running, if I use my favorite. Yeah. So, Arvind, again, I don't know whether I answered that question, because I know a lot of people are looking for very definitive answers to some of these problems, and I'm trying to dissuade people from imagining that there is any definitive answer. And if there is one definitive answer, it's inside of you and not outside of you, and you got to discover it.
Hello, sir. Sir, my name is Ritamjit, and sir, you talked about leading a life where most of the decisions you made were based on field-based decisions. But the reality for us today is different, because most of the things, the books we buy, most of the places we visit, restaurants we visit to, they are based on our experiences on social media or how recommended systems are putting those in front of us. So, and at the core of all this is, again, as you said, machine learning, cognitive intelligence, and so on. So, do you see that the human race evolving to produce a better human being, or do you see loss of freedom in this?
So, you know, again, I think it has to depart from define on what is the purpose or what do you want. So I, for one, is I don't read any reviews. I am not part of any marketing scheme. I have never used any loyalty points, neither airline nor credit card, anything. And the reason for some of those things is that I think some of these are, to my mind, very distractive. I said, I want to be free of doing whatever I feel like. If I have to buy a shirt, I don't care whether there's a discount or a sale or someone else recommended. So that's the type of person I have become. I enjoy that freedom of that choice without any constraints. And yeah, of course, if I was, let's say I had fewer resources and I had to optimize, I could. But I have tried to maybe that's how I am. I don't have too many, you know, desires. So where do people spend money? Housing, you know, cars, vacations, or travel, or some of those things. I've lived in the same house for the last 12 years. I've been driving the same car for the last 12 years. My kids have been studying in the same school for the last 12 years. In fact, I used to work in the same company for the last 11, 12 years, where, by the way, the salary was increasing. The rest of the things, the inflation was not as high as in the salary side. So therefore, to some extent, I would say I was privileged to not so much worry about those concerns. And I don't like taking vacations. For me, a run is very good, very fine. My kids don't go to an international school. Like I said, so for me, the material needs were not a worry, because they were very few. I used to buy some shoes, 5,000-6,000 rupees for running, and then I started doing barefoot running, so the need for shoes is likely to go down as well. So I don't drink or smoke or do any of those things. So for me, there were few things that I like, and I don't care about what they cost and when I buy it. So that's who I am, and therefore I got rid of it. So I don't have any loyalty card in my pocket. I don't worry about anything. I don't take anything. So that makes me feel free. So you have to figure out what makes you feel free. You don't have to worry reviews, read reviews just because they're out there. So many a times, like I said, that whole, the second confidence part, do you have the confidence to know what you want? Many a times, we are just, like I said, spoiled for choice. I don't worry about which next toothpaste I should buy. I don't look at 50 toothpaste. I have something. I like it. I'll do it, whatever. So I think it comes from that define or that purpose. So as long as you can get that right, I think the rest becomes so easy that, you know, but I think if you have to get to feel comfortable in your skin that this is who I am and this is what I want, I think it takes some time. Because in this today's world, and you see some of those stand-up comedians about Facebook, that when you open it up, you see everyone enjoying life and you are the only one seem to be who is depressed. It makes you even more depressed. Then you go search for blue whale and, you know, whatever. So I think that inner confidence, and I might sound like a philosophical discussion, but I think that's probably the root of everything else. And since that is not there, people go after the Dera Baba, after some other Baba or whatever else. I think it's all inside. And if you find that, no one else is required. Don't look for validation. That's my one learning.
Good afternoon, sir. So, sir, since you have worked in banks like ICICI Bank, and then you are currently working in Wells Fargo, what is the difference that you actually see the way the companies like Wells Fargo and JP Morgan operate and the way our banks operate, considering like the financial crisis which happened back in 2008? So will that not happen again? What are the measures that are being taken on the Indian side, plus the banks like big banks like Wells Fargo and all?
So I'll share with you what I think has happened so far, and again, what I think might happen in the future. So in the past, you know, I think the Western economies were growing at a much more rapid pace. And I think their desire for material things was even more rapid than what they could produce. So I think the idea of taking debt to buy, so you know, you are kind of, you know, taking the future earnings and taking it now, that became a big issue. So, you know, you were just, what is a loan? You are, you know, mortgaging your future earning for that. I think that was a huge deal where, you know, today a lot of kids, at least in the large, you know, US and many other places, are worried because they get out of college with a huge loan. So they're already on the defensive, right? Similarly about, you know, mortgage and many of these things. So I think some and that probably is a natural evolution, that the society through the debt binge just became, it's just out of the world. So it is very highly leveraged society, very, you know, materialistic in that sense and so on. I think India is still not there. We are still, you know, on a, even when we do that 2040 surpassing of the US, I think our per capita GDP will probably still remain far lower than the top rich nations, right, on an average, because we have so many people and we continue to produce more of them. So I think therefore, while in numbers and aggregate, we might become big, but we are still sort of on an average basis, not as big. So the consumption is still not there. So I think we still don't have that problem. And I would say that, you know, our, you know, regulators and our, you know, policymakers have tried to curb the growth of banking and some of it learning from the experience of the others, because, you know, some other people have faced that. So you become more cautious. And RBI and some of our, you know, central banks are actually lauded globally for good policy making and being more conservative and so on. And some of the others are sort of assumed to have, you know, not been so conservative and allowed some of these crises to happen. So now, in our case, some of the crisis that is already in there is more related to, you know, corruption and those types of practices where some of those loans were not given with the due diligence and so on, and they are now getting addressed in certain ways. So I think we are in a very different stage of our evolution compared to many of the, you know, Western countries. Future, I think, again, like I said, is very, very difficult to predict. But I do think that that conservatism in our economic growth in terms of, you know, allowing debt to be this thing is there. In fact, there are, if you look at some of the tax policies, they are saying if you have a second house or a third house, we will tax you more, we won't give you benefits and all that. So those types of things are just totally open in the US. People are getting ninja loans, no income, no job, no asset, and, you know, get three houses and so on. So those types of things, I think we have learned our lessons, and I think we will probably follow a very different path. I think the other reason we'll follow a very different path is, I think, the way we are digitizing. So I think our country is also going to have a very different path. Just like in the mobile phones, we went ahead to, didn't have, go through the fixed line revolution, we leapfrogged to mobile. I think in the banking area also, all these, the way we are using digital technologies for payments and other things, I think will be very different. And also backed by the whole Aadhaar stack. Have you guys heard of Aadhaar stack? There are these four levels of Aadhaar. So Aadhaar is the basic level, which is the, you know, your identification layer. Then you have the payment layer. So they say presenceless meaning our presence, you know, through your biometric. And then there is paperless, which is no documents. Government will have all documents digitized. You don't have to have all these verifications, KYC forms, nothing. Your driving license should be in your DigiLocker. Then UPI, which is the payment layer, which is one example of UPI. And the last one, which is still in the works, is called the consent layer, that you should own your data. That's related to privacy. So if all of these comes in, and all sort of sponsored by the government and not private sector, that's a big difference. Most of these technologies and most of these frameworks and marketplaces are private elsewhere. And private works very differently from how the government works. So I think we have taken a very different path, in my opinion, on the economic and financial self using digital technology, that we will create some ecosystems around our digital highways will be very different from what has been done there, which is the other reason we need people here to think differently. Because anyway, we are so used to following what they did, and therefore you can only catch up, and the catch up doesn't work. How do you think differently? Which is where I am very, very fascinated by the startup ecosystem in our country, where youngsters who don't know any better, which is good, are doing something which has not been done before.
So you like you said, the in future market, the market which are existing now might not be there, and might be new market can come up. But you proposed the 3C framework to your daughter. So I get the confidence part, I get the creativity part, but why did you think of compassion as the first element of it?
You know, you have to, you know, and like I said, they are in that order. They are for a reason. I think you have to first start from you know, who are you trying to serve? Or in which context are you operating? So today the context is, I am operating for myself. If that is the context, it's a very limited context. You will optimize yourself. You will build your career. You might kick some other fellows. You won't worry about the environment. You might not. So I think the context, if you do it in a limited way, it will only take you somewhere. And it does take people somewhere. Compassion to me means that you're always thinking of a much more broader context and not in a philanthropic or a idealistic or a spiritual way. You can apply those things also if you like, but in a very, very practical way, because that larger context will allow you a much larger runway to play on. You know, you have heard many people who are just doing it for themselves. They run out of runway very soon, because soon that runway is short. And people who are doing it for a much larger crowd, they never run out of runway and become Mahatma and come on the, you know, banknotes, right? So it depends, you know, and you don't have to be that or this. I think somewhere in between, wherever you feel comfortable, is a practically longer runway. Because all of you will live for average 90 years, and they make you retire at 60. What will you do for the next 30? In fact, these days people are retiring at 40. What will you do for the next 50? So I think you want to have a longer runway. So I keep telling people that don't look at point optimization. How can my next salary will be better than everyone else? You'll get there. But is that the answer? Or are you looking at area under the curve for a 90-year period?
So you say you're doing engineering, and then you chose to do the course in IIM because you didn't like that the bachelor's part. You didn't do it for your master's. But then you again said go for the first job you get. First job might not be the same domain that you want or the same thing that you want for yourself. Then how do you address that thing?
So first my part. So I think me and I think most people choose things by elimination and not passion. Most people, some people do. So that's what led to that. So I eliminated master. Not that I liked MBA, because in fact I was scared of MBA because you have to talk. I couldn't talk. Very difficulty, I got that. But I said, going to US and studying electrical engineering, this doesn't look like that. So maybe looks better. Whatever. So it wasn't really a choice following a passion. And because none of us know any better. So I also think that, you know, if you have to take a next degree, work for a while, understand what you want, and then acquire what you think is required. The reason I say that for a first job is a lot of people, you know, try to, you know, overcomplicate frameworks on what they want. And many times some of those variables and some of those things are not as relevant. And therefore, even if you went into a job and after 6 months you realize you made an absolute wrong choice, you have a choice. No, you know, no one is, you know, binding you for that. So change it. Who said you have to retire in a job? Like I said, the whole idea of lifetime employment and all of that is a thing of the past. It used to happen in Japanese company, in our public sector companies. But now companies will not exist for so long. Forget, I mean, companies don't have a lifetime. Your lifetime is increasing, company lifetime is contracting. If you look at the data, that is for everyone to see. Human lifetime is increasing, company lifetime is contracting. CEO lifetime is contracting. So you are up against a very known force that you can't hope, just based on odds, to remain in a job for too long. It will, the market is forcing you to have a shorter and shorter lifespan. If that be the case, why are you so worried about getting married to the first job? Marriage as an institution is a different topic altogether.
Sir, my question is that can you throw up some light in differentiating the differences between business analytics, data science, big data analytics, and what are the differences, I mean, major differences or minor differences between each of these terms? And what is the role that we are going to do in the industry?
So, first of all, I would say don't get too fussed about these definitions. Because, you know, just think of how these definitions come about. Usually, a management thinker or a consulting company, all frameworks, if you look at the history, will come from there. Because that's how they use it to sell. And they have to sell, so they have to come up with some framework. People were hiring 5-6 years ago, chief analytics officers. Then a couple of years ago, they said, we are hiring chief digital officers. Last week, a friend of mine said, now they are hiring chief AI officers. No, so they will keep changing the terms, right? But the underlying thing has not changed in the same way, right? The cover has changed or people have started to think differently and all that. So I think any of those definitions that you say are good, and you can call it something and someone else might interpret different. End of the day, what do companies do? How are they organized today? And what could you do is the real question, right? So most companies typically have business and technology. And these types of careers that you are going to encounter will be in sort of that, either in one or the other, or sometime in between the two. Those are the types of jobs that exist in the market today. So most companies, the technology teams came from, the application, the infrastructure, and those things. You have the software. We called it the IT industry, the information technology industry, but there was no information ever. Information technology should have been big data, right? Why are we talking about big data over 30 years of the IT industry in India and the IT industry is exist? Because everyone was not using data. They were talking information, but they were doing only technology. So the I in the IT has now started to become relevant because I think they've got bored of T and they said, let's do something about I. But the cloud at the same time has disrupted this whole edifice, which the CIOs used to hold, where big data centers, big investments, all those things that the IT teams used to hold is now going away to the cloud because you have variabilized all of that. You can buy CPU, you can buy storage, you can buy compute capacity, you can buy anything. You swipe a card on AWS, you get what you want for as long as you want, right? So therefore, that whole edifice of large investments in data centers is going to continue to erode. They'll erode at different paces in different companies. Startups are already there. Large banks or large pharma companies, which are far more regulated, far more investment in the past, will go there last. Some people will go there first, but that's the trend, and that is given, and that's the right trend because that's a more flexible and productive trend. So that's where it is headed. And therefore, the IT teams within the company are saying, if we are not spending so much time on provisioning the infrastructure or creating the application because we are able to do other things, how can we use the information also to help the business? So many times there are roles of business and data analytics type of role, that the skills that you are acquiring are sitting inside of IT teams, where they're hiring now people of this scale saying, okay, you understand the technology, but you also know how to harness data. So to serve our departments, the other business function, we can give them more instead of just provisioning the application and saying we have the uptime. We can do more than that. So that's what those teams are doing. At the same time, the business teams have always been using data and analytics, and they were hiring analysts to do marketing modeling or all kinds of other things in supply chain and all of that. They are asking those team members to understand technology, because today it's very hard to do analysis if you don't have a good understanding of technology. So if you look at this whole field of big data, data science, data analytics, all that thing, the types of skills that are available is really, three levels. How do you extract data from wherever it is, that whole ETL, the extraction part of it. The second is the modeling part of it. So while you have extracted, and that extraction and cleansing is a field in itself, and there are different software and all that, then the modeling part of it, saying, okay, how do you make sense out of it? And the third, the most important part is saying, okay, but why are we doing it, and what do we do with it, which is the business context part of it. Now, there are some people who are saying, if you are the truest data scientist, you should know it all. You are sitting, and you, by the way, are that if you are running a startup. Because if you're running a startup or a small company, then you are thinking of the business context. You're also thinking of the tool and technology and the business model, and you are probably doing it on your own. So that's in a startup mode. But large companies, because of scale, tend to split up these roles depending on the size of the company and the nature of the company into various parts. So you might just be a visualization person, and then you have to learn Tableau and Power BI and all kinds of things. You might just be an ETL person. You might just be a modeling person. But I just think that you should continue to expand the boundary of whatever you are today. Because anything, if you remain static, it's, I think, a risky proposition. I think it's good to be a specialist in something, but the things are changing so fast and they are so interconnected that someone who knows it all can package it together better than you can, or better than four of you can. Because if you knew all the pieces of the puzzle, you know how to optimize each of it, versus someone who just knows one part of the puzzle and four of them come together and they don't know what the other part is. So I do think having an appreciation for all the other parts, if not specialization, does help you to do a better job even in what you are doing. Because if you were even a data extraction person, but you had a sense of how modeling works or how visualization in business context works, you'll do a better job here. Similarly, if you were there, if you know the others better, you could do a better job. So don't box yourself into a role or a job family. Be there, but acquire adjacent skills so that you can be better and continue to evolve. I don't know. Is that the question or the answer you're looking for? I think they're tired. Sure.
How does the system make data more reliable? And what is the level of
So like I just answered that question that wherever you have to make a model, models are mostly statistical. Again, people tend to feel that, they have to learn statistics. But, if you are in the data science field, you can still be an expert in many other fields. If you are not a stats person, you can be that, as long as you have a sense of how that works. So I just think that, the question really usually people ask is, do I need to know it all? And I say no, but you need to know one or two very well, and you need to have an appreciation of the others reasonably well so that you can do a better job. So yeah, statistics is important, but if you are not that, I'll get someone else, but you have to have something. So don't worry about what you don't have. You tell me what you have. I'll figure out how to pair you with someone else who has the complementary skills. Because people sometimes say, okay, I don't know this, will you hire me? I said, I'm not going to hire people for what they don't have. I'm going to hire people for what they have. So focus on your strengths. Focus on what you're good at. We don't hire Tiger Woods to play cricket, nor Tendulkar to play golf. We always hire them to play what they're good at and tend to hone their skills. And if you guys have not heard of a tool called Strength Finder, go buy this book called Strength Finder. Take a test. It will tell you what your top five strengths are. Hone your strengths. Don't worry about your weakness.
And I think the last question for today, what are the products or tools that the candidate must be aware of in the financial and banking sectors if they want to enter the industry as a data scientist?
I think, like I said, again, there is no industry, framework. In fact, there is not even a company framework. In my companies that I have worked for, there were teams that were working on Power BI, they were working on Tableau, they were working on something else, they were working on Hadoop, they were working on SQL, all of that. So I think large companies today have a need for every possible thing. In fact, many a times, the more older the technology is, the more difficult to get skills in, because everyone is getting trained in the future product. And in places like banking and pharma, like I said, which have a huge investment in the past, I remember in one time, we couldn't find people knowing COBOL, because no one wanted to learn COBOL, because COBOL was supposed to be dead. But COBOL still works on a lot of systems in many companies, right? So I think if you are trying to, get a great job, you can actually get it in doing something really old technology that no one else is wanting to do, right? And many times people do those odd jobs that no one else is doing and still maximize your, value to the company or to yourself. So I think you have to figure out. It's a question of supply and demand. Everyone is right now going to the highest end data science. Everyone is learning Python and everyone is learning R. Go find something else. Maybe that might become in demand later on. So go figure something new out, because those things everyone will do. So like I said, follow the herd. It's okay. You can't go wrong with that. But do something beyond the herd also.